Hello friend, I am Professor S. D. Kade. I am going to deliver a lecture on microwave measurement, in particular a power and impedance measurement. Now we know that what is a microwave. A microwave is nothing but a wave that is having a frequency in between 300 megahertz to 3 gigahertz, that is called as microwave frequencies. And these microwave signals will have different parameters like power, impedance, frequency, wavelength. Now in this particular lecture we are going to consider a power measurement. Now the frequency as well as the power can be measured directly. The most of the power measurement techniques use suitable calibrated power detectors which convert the RF power into a heat, and then by measuring the temperature rise by a temperature sensitive element, the power is read directly or indirectly. The power requirements in microwave or in radar are quite high, that is in the kilowatt, while that of microwave solid devices is quite low, that is few milliwatt. Now therefore a power measurement technique are different as per the power level and divided into the following four categories. So first category is very low power, that is 0.01 milliwatt to 1 milliwatt, and for this a thermocouple technique is used. Second, low power, that is having a power between 0.1 milliwatt to 10 milliwatt. For this we are utilizing a bolometer technique. Third is medium power, that is having a power in between 10 milliwatt to 10 watt. For this we are use an extension of bolometer technique with a 20 dB directional coupler. And fourth is high power, that is from 10 watt to 1 kilowatt. And for this technique we are, for this power we are using a calorimetric technique. Now let's see very low power measurement, means that having a power between the range 0.01 to 1 milliwatt. And for this a thermocouple method is used. Now for this level of power SVBI thermal couples are used, where one of the junction is connected to conducting plate that is put inside a transmission line where a microwave is flowing. And this plate will get heated and the EMF gets generated between SB and BI, and which is measured suitably by a calibrated voltmeter. And this way the voltmeter can directly read a microwave power, that is a very low power. Now next is a measurement of low power measurement, that is in the range 0.1 milliwatt to 10 milliwatt. And for this power measurement we are utilizing a bolometer method. So for this we use a bolometer, which is a microwave power detectors, in which an internal resistance changes that may increase or decrease with a rise in temperature caused by a microwave power dissipating inside them. And there are the two types of the devices. One is barometers and another is thermistors. Now let's see a barometers. It has a resistance with a positive temperature coefficient, consists of a fine platinum wire that is mounted in a cartridge-like fuse. Okay, so this is a bolometer element, and this is a fine platinum wire. Now, this is mounted on this case. So here we have seen the graph. Here a temperature is goes on rising from T1 to T2. And we can see that the resistance of a bolometer element is also goes on rising. So for T1 it is having a resistance R1, and for T2 it will having a resistance R2. So this is a barometer that is 5 ohm per milliwatt. So here in this particular figure you can see that here we are applying a microwave power, and that is dissipated in this bolometer. And here the microwave power will generate a heat, and that heat will increase the resistance of this bolometer element. And here we are directly readings taken a readings using a calibrated voltmeter. Now next, a thermistor. So it has a resistance with a negative temperature coefficient consisting of semiconductor material. So here from this graph we see that the temperature is goes on rising from T1 to T0, T2, and the resistance is goes on rising from R, sorry, it goes on decreasing, that is from R1 to R2. Now it is connected in this particular bridge. So there, this is nothing but the bolometer element that is used. Now, both of these bolometer are a square law devices like a diode detector, and hence the power increases with the temperature, which in turn either increase or decrease in the resistance of the element by a square law, and therefore the microwave power is proportional to, that is R2 minus R1. Now let's see the power measurement using bolometer method in detail. Now we know that we are using a bolometer method and we have to measure a microwave power. So the unknown RF power, that is nothing but a microwave power, is observed specially in a specially constructed bolometer methods that having a resistive material. Now here, as the temperature is goes on rising, the result of this temperature rise is detected by measuring a change in the bolometer resistance by means of auxiliary bridge circuit. Now this technique is suitable for power ranging from few milliwatt to a fraction of watt. Now here we can see The figure of bolometer method measurement of low microwave power. Now here you can see that here RF power is entered into a coaxial line with a short-tempered section. This short-tempered section to transform the line impedance to that of the bolometer. And a lambda by 4 stub is used to provide a ground return for a bolometer bridge connection, but it doesn't influence the RF portion of the circuit. So here this is nothing but a bolometer element. Now, below this bolometer element, we are having a bypass capacitor. So, this is used to provide a return path of RF current and insulated connection to the bolometer. Now the resistance change in the bolometer is measured using this ABCD bridge. So in which the arm CD is supplied the resistance of the bolometer element. So this arm will provide the resistance of this bolometer element. The bridge is excited simultaneously by direct current E, direct current that will be emitting from E, and by an alternating voltage of audio frequency. And thus the bolometer element is simultaneously heated by the DC power, the audio frequency power, and the radio frequency power. Now it is being measured. However, the resistance of the bolometer is depend upon the total power, and it is independent of whether this power comes from. So, a nominal voltage is applied to audio supply, and it is superimposed upon the RF being measured or microwave power being measured. Now, direct current from E is next adjusted by a rheostat R until the heating of the bolometer element causes its resistance to have a required value to balance the bridge as indicated by a galvanometer G. Now, the RF power, that is microwave power, is then turned off. Now due to that it will unbalance a bridge because a change in bolometer resistance as a result of less heating. Now balance is restored by increasing the amount of power from audio frequency supply, and since the bolometer resistance depend upon the total power regardless of the frequency and the RF power is exactly equals to the radio frequency power added to rebalance the bridge, and that is nothing but the value of RF power or the microwave power. Now let's see, let if V1 is the voltage of audio frequency supply with a reflected power turn on, and V2 is voltage of audio frequency supply with reflected power is turn off. Then we can get a reflected power as V2 square into V1 square divided by 4 R1. So where R1 is the resistance of a bolometer element at a balance condition. Now likewise, we are going to measure the microwave power. Now to have a greatest accuracy, audio power will initially supplied a bolometer element should not be large compared with the reflected power being measured or the microwave power being measured. Now next is a medium power measurement, that is ranging from 10 milliwatt to 10 watt. Now in this technique we use the bolometer method by extending a 20 dB directional coupler. So as the both bolometer, that is positive and negative temperature coefficients, are limited their power handling capability up to 10 milliwatts only, and therefore a 20 dB directional coupler with a 10 dB attenuator can be used so that the power is reduced by 30 dB, that is 1 divided by 10,000, and thus it increases the power capability up to 10 milliwatt, as 10 watt divided by 1000 becomes equals to 10 milliwatt. But it costs the accuracy. The attenuator could be precise variable type also. Now this is a setup for measurement of medium power, that is ranging from 10 milliwatt to 10 watt. So here we have used this directional coupler with this 10 dB attenuator so that we are going to down the power by 30 dB. Therefore, whatever the devices, bolometer element that is suitable for 10 milliwatt, now able to measure the power of 10 watt. So here microwave power will be inserted and that will be comes to this particular port, and then it is passed to this 10 dB variable attenuator, and then it is supplied to the bolometer element that is connected to this particular bridge, and likewise we are going to measure the medium power. Now let's see the high power measurement, that is ranging from 10 watt to 15 kilowatt. So for this we are using a calorimeter method. Now in this method, a calorimeter method where the microwave power is dissipated in a perfectly absorbing load and then sensing the power level from rise in the temperature. So it uses a circulating water being a bipolar observer of a microwave energy, and here the water is constantly flowing through a glass tube passing through a shorted end. Now this method involves a conversion of RF energy, microwave energy, into heat and then absorbing this heat in fluid, usually the water. which flow through the system, and then measuring the temperature rise of the fluid. Now it is essential that a RF power being transferred to the fluid. The system will have a no RF leakages because heat losses from the fluid must be minimized, and this method is specially suited for the large power measurement. So these are the precautions to be taken, that is no RF leakages will be there. If RF leakage are there, then a heat losses within the fluid will be takes place. Now the RF section must be designed to provide a proper impedance transformation in order to the load impedance that adequately match the power source. The RF power must be transformed to the fluid in such a that way to avoid a hot spot where a boiling point of a fluid might occur. Now here, as we have seen, here we are entering a RF input power, then this is a lossy cable, here a water jacket is there, then this is nothing but a thermal insulation, and here we are shorting this or opening this terminal. Now as we have seen, we are continuously flowing water through this particular setup. So here water in is there, we are measuring a temperature by thermometer. Here the water will be taken out from this setup, and again here we are measuring a temperature. Now the power dissipated in this calorimeter is calculated using this particular relation, that P become equals to 4.18 m sp del t, where m is a flow of water, that is gram per second, sp is a specific heat in calories per gram per degree Celsius, delta t is a temperature rise in degree Celsius, and P is a power in watt. Now the rate at which the fluid flow and the mass of the fluid exposed to the heating should be proportional, so that the measurement of the temperature rise is obtained with a small amount of fluid can absorb a desired power, and this assured that it is not too sluggish to the changes in the power level. It utilizes a length of lossy cable to observe the power, and this cable is available in the standard impedance of 50 ohm, and hence there is no problem of impedance matching to the RF system. The fluid serves as a coolant, observing a no RF power itself. The length of the cable should be sufficient to provide an attenuation of 10 dB or more at operating frequency, and this ensured that at least a 20 dB of attenuation in the reflected power, and thus load absorbs virtually all the incident power delivered by the source. And this is a method, calorimeter method, is used for 5 to 500 watts of microwave power. Now next thing is impedance measurement. Now impedance at a microwave frequency can be measured using any of the following method. So first method is using magic tea, second using slotted line, and third using reflectometer. Now, impedance measurement using magic tea. A magic tea is nothing but a combination of H plane tea and E plane tea. It is also called as a hybrid tea. So it is a four port network. It is a frequently employed in a micro impedance measuring bridges. These bridges are similar to the low frequency Wheatstone bridges, and typically a magic tee is utilizing for a impedance measurement. So this is a setup to utilize for the impedance measurement. So this is a magic tee. Magic tee is nothing but a four port network. Here at port 3, a micro generator is connected. At port 2, a load that impedance is to be measured is connected. At port 1, we are connecting a known impedance load that is denoted as ZR, and we have to find out this load, that is ZL. And at port 4, we have connected a match detector. Now, the power from the match source is fed into the port 3, that is nothing but H arm of the magic tee. A standard variable impedance is connected at port 1 as a reference impedance, and port 2 is shorted or terminated by an impedance that is being measured. A match detector is connected at port 4, that is the E arm of a magic tee, to receive the power reflected from port 1 and port 2. And this power are out of 180 degree phase. The reference impedance is so adjusted that have no signals in the detector. Now, under this condition, the power reflected from the reference impedance and reaching to the detector, a half of the reflected power equal to the power reflected from the unknown impedance reaching at the detector. Because the two power are out of phase, the length of the port are equal. That is, when we can say the bridge is balanced, then we can write ZR minus Z0 plus ZR plus Z0, that becomes equals to ZL minus Z0 upon ZL plus Z0, or we can write ZR conjugate minus 1 upon ZR conjugate plus 1 equals to ZL conjugate minus 1 upon ZL conjugate plus 1. So where rho R or ZR as respectively the reflective coefficient and normalized impedance of the reference impedance, where rho L or ZL are the respective quantities for the unknown impedance. And by using the above equation, we can determine a ZL in terms of ZR. Now next method is impedance measurement using a floated line section. Now here the incident and reflected waves will be present, and that is proportional to the mismatch of load under the test, or the impedance is being measured. Now that resulting in a standing wave, and from that standing wave we are going to determine the type of load is connected. So this is a microwave bench setup, microwave source, then isolator, then frequency meter, then slotted line section, then unknown load. So here a crystal detector is connected, and that is connected to the power meter. Now using the slotted line waveguide with a load ZL in the circuit, the V max and V minimum can accurately determine. Now the load ZL is replaced by a short termination and shift in minimum is measured. Now if the minimum is shifted to the left, so that means a load is inductive, and if it is shifted to right, it means load is capacitive, and the both impedance and the reflection coefficient can be obtained in a magnitude and phase. So this is we are going to measure from setup 1 and setup 2. Now from the setup 1 we have measured a V minimum and V maximum, and using the setup 2 by short terminating a setup by short terminal. Now if this minimum point is shifted to the left, that means the load is inductive, and if this minimum point is shifted to right side, then it means a load is capacitive. Now next, the impedance measurement using a reflectometer. Now reflectometer indicates a magnitude of the impedance but not a phase angle. A typical setup will utilize two hole directional coupler to sample the incident power, and that is defined as PR, and the reflected power, that is PR, from the load. Now both directional couplers are identical. The magnitude of the reflection coefficient rho can directly be obtained by the reflectometer with which impedance is to be calculated. Now this is a reflectometer setup. We are feeding a microwave source PI, then we are having attenuator, then we have connected a forward two hole directional coupler that having attenuation of 20 dB. So with the help of a forward detector we are going to measure the forward power, that is PI, and here we are having a reverse two hole directional coupler that is again having attenuation of 20 dB. Now here we are having a reverse detector. This is going to measure a reverse power, that is PR, and here we are having load, that is Z, or impedance, that is being measured. Now the reflection coefficient can be obtained as an under root of reflected power divided by incident power, and with the help of this two hole directional coupler we can going to measure a forward power and the reflected power. So that is given as under root of PR divided by 100 upon PI divided by 100. So this is a reflection coefficient that rho becomes equals to under root of P r divided by P i, and from this we can calculate the VSWR, that is 1 plus rho divided by 1 minus rho, and rho becomes equals to z minus zg upon z plus zg. So where zg is the unknown wave impedance, zg is a known impedance, and z is being unknown impedance, then s is VSWR, and the rho is a reflection coefficient. Now, because a directional coupler properties, there will be no interference being reversed or a forward wave, and attenuation on 10 dB pads used to keep the input power at low level. The accuracy of this refractometer is greater for low VSWR. Thank you for watching.
Thank you for watching this video lecture. Now like, subscribe and press a bell icon. Thank you.